Good afternoon. Welcome to Combustion Engineering. Today we're going to talk about heat transfer. Before we do that, I witnessed something this morning that was kind of interesting to me. You guys have probably heard people talk about somebody playing possum to pretend they're dead. So this morning, I went outside, took the dog out to go to the bathroom, and I hear this commotion, and the dog's caught a possum. And he shook it really hard. I thought for sure he killed it. It was just laying there. It looked like it was dead. So I took the dog back in the house, came out about 30 minutes later with a shovel to bury it, and it was gone. So it did a really good job of playing possum because I thought for sure it was dead. Nothing to do with combustion engineering, but I'd never seen that before, and I saw it in person for that. Last Thursday, you had a presentation by Brian Beck on flare radiation. Today, we'll talk about heat transfer, and then next two sessions will be Bill Johnson talking about process heaters and process burners. All of these presentations have already been posted, so if you want to get a peek ahead, you can. All right, so heat transfer. If I get my thing not locked up. Okay. A little bit of terminology, won't go through this. Probably many of you have already had heat transfer. What's going to be different about this is that we'll talk about heat transfer specifically applied to the kinds of industries that we work in. After this, you should be able to define heat transfer, list the three main mechanisms for heat transfer, and we'll spend a little bit of time talking about how heat transfers in a combustor. So it'll be divided into two sections, heat transfer mechanisms, and then how is it applied to industrial combustion equipment. More information in Chapter 7 of Volume 1. All right, so heat transfer mechanisms, three of them, conduction, convection, radiation. We'll take them in that order. Some folks will add things like boiling and condensation. They are heat transfer mechanisms, and they do play a role in many of our industries. For our purposes here, we're just going to focus on these three. So heat's defined as energy in transit. It's moving. If you've had thermodynamics, you talked a lot about heat transfer. In that case, though, you didn't really care how long it took. In heat transfer, you didn't care how long it takes and the intensity of it, whereas for thermo, we're just interested in the bulk amount. We looked at heat transfer and work, and again, not any amount of time, how long that took. Some common units in the U.S., we use British thermal units. This is one of the idiosyncrasies. I'm not sure why this is, but technically, you don't capitalize the T and the U. I think you should, but the correct way is actually you don't capitalize them. I don't know why. It doesn't make sense to me. Kcals and joules are also common units. So in our business, since we deal internationally as well as domestically, we use all of these units. And some conversions, if you need to go between units, there's some conversions for that. So heat transfer goes from a high temperature to a low temperature. And when we're going to heat something in a furnace, we normally have a flame. We've talked a little bit about flames. The rest of the course, we're going to talk a lot about flames. Those are going to be hotter than whatever it is we're heating. And so we're going to transfer heat from that flame. So then heat transfer is the energy transfer per unit time. Again, unlike in thermo, where we didn't care how long something took, in this case, we are going to care about that. So heat flux is heat transfer per unit area. We do care about that for sure because we can have too much heat flux. And if we have too much heat flux, then we can cause damage to equipment. One of the challenges in process heaters specifically is to try to squeeze as much energy as you can in the smallest footprint possible. And there are some guidelines about how much energy per cubic in either foot or volume or meter or per square foot or square meter of floor area. And so there'll be guidelines for both of those. The clients would like to put as much energy as they can, but if you put too much again, you can have some problems. In that industry, if you overheat it, then you cause coke formation inside the tube. That hinders heat transfer, it overheats the tube, and often leads to a rupture. So again, we have to be careful not to put too much energy in a given space. Here are some units for heat flux. Again, energy per unit time per unit area, or per square area. You could even have it per cubic area if you wanted to look at it in terms of an energy density. If we have a furnace and we've got a process tube inside that furnace, and we want to add a certain amount of energy. Again, we're trying to heat some hydrocarbon fluid that's flowing through that tube. And if we had 10, or we needed this kind of heat flux and we had that much energy that we had to put in, then you need to size the tube so you can figure out the area easy enough. So we would divide the energy needed by the heat flux, and we would say that we would need 10 square feet of tube surface area. So given the size of the tube, that would tell us how long we would need to be. These tubes and process heaters are typically around 6 inches in diameter, so you can figure out how long you'd have to make for that. So that's a flux, and we can look at the heat transfer mechanisms with something as simple as a coffee mug. So why do we make mugs out of ceramic? They're fragile, right? If I drop it on something hard, it's gonna break. So why do we do that? Keeps the heat in. It also keeps the heat off of the people holding it, right? So you don't burn your hand. So you can look at conduction. Conduction is direct contact. You have to touch it to feel the conduction. If we have convection, so let's say you pour your coffee in the morning and it's too hot. What do? Well, you typically blow on it, right? You could stick it in the refrigerator. You could just sit it there and wait till it cools down. But we're usually impatient, so we blow on it. You could blow against the ceramic, and that would cool it down, but it would take you a while to do that, right? Because it's a pretty good insulator. So what do we usually do? We blow against the liquid, right, to cool it faster. If your fingers are sensitive enough, you can feel heat in a ceramic mug without actually even touching it. And that's by radiation, electromagnetic waves. So we use these, but sometimes folks use stainless steel. Is stainless steel a good conductor or a poor conductor? It's a good conductor, unlike ceramic, which is a poor conductor. So why would you use something that's a good conductor to keep heat in? You do something inside to keep the heat in. So it could be a vacuum, it could be some insulation. One of the things we like about, well, a couple things we like about stainless steel, looks cool, it's easy to clean, it's really strong, you drop it on the floor, it might dent, but it won't break. So here's something to trick your non-engineering friends. And I have done this before, and you get some humorous answers. When you have a thermos, you put hot fluids in there, keeps them hot. You put cold fluids in there, keeps them cold. How does the thermos know which one is in there? So again, ask your non-engineering friends and you will get their heads, their eyes will roll back in their head and they will wonder, and you might get some funny answers about how does the thermos know what's in there. Okay. So some key things when we look at heat transfer, the source and the sink temperature, that's the driving force. That delta T between the high and the low temperature is what drives heat transfer. We're going to see that for conduction and convection, it's just a linear temperature difference. In the case of radiation, it's raised to the fourth power, so it's going to be much more dependent on those temperatures. It's going to depend on the geometry, what's the shape of the object, if it has flow to it, how is the flow hitting that object, how is it oriented. For radiation, again, we have view factors, so how the radiation is seen from one surface to another. Obviously, it depends on the properties, like the thermal conductivity, convection coefficient, things like that. So all of those fit in there. We're not going to go into a whole lot of detail on these. I'm going to assume that you've had some of this, at least in physics, if not a formal course in heat transfer. If we compare the methods then, we've got these three methods. In terms of what can it transfer heat through, in the case of conduction, stationary solid, liquid, or gas. The key is it's not moving. We can conduct through a liquid and a gas, for example, but many times those liquids and gases are moving. If they are moving, then we would say it's convection. So really the main difference is, in the case of conduction, it's not moving. In the case of convection, it is. In radiation, it can transfer through anything, whether it's stationary or moving, as long as it's transparent to the radiation. So that's the only requirement there. Again, for conduction and convection, linear temperature difference, delta T, T hot minus T cold. In the case of radiation, it's T hot to the fourth minus T cold to the fourth, and those have to be in absolute temperatures. So those are the significant differences. If you looked, for example, we had a hot temperature of 470 and a cold temperature of 70 degrees, then the delta T would be 400. If we raise the high temperature up to 870, then we can double the heat transfer, assuming everything else is the same, because now we have doubled the delta T. So pretty straightforward there. So heat transfer then, we're always interested in what's the net heat transfer. When, for example, you talk about radiation, everything in this room right now is radiating, but if we are at the same temperature as each other approximately, then we're not really, there's no net heat transfer between us. There is a little bit of net heat transfer between us and the surroundings. It's not quite as hot as we are. So we're always looking at what's the difference, not necessarily what's one temperature versus the other, but what's the difference between the two. Again, that's going to be really important in a furnace. So for those major mechanisms of that, then let's look at each one individually. Conduction, then, we have conduction through a solid. We'll just consider in this course one-dimensional plane conduction. There are certainly much more complicated situations than this, but for our purposes, this will serve. And your homework problem for this section is going to be on conduction, so I'll try to talk about it as we go through there. We have a high temperature and a low temperature, and assuming that the thermal conductivity doesn't vary with temperature or doesn't vary very much with temperature, then we have a straight line for temperature through there, and we have some thickness X, and we can write the equation, Fourier's law of conduction for 1D conduction through a plane surface to be that. Pretty simple equation, thermal conductivity of the material, T hot minus T cold, and then divided by the thickness of the material. So pretty easy. Obviously different materials have different thermal conductivities. Sometimes we want very high conductivities. If we have a heat sink, for example, we often make heat sinks out of things like aluminum, high conductivity and relatively inexpensive. So most of our electronic devices have some kind of mechanism to keep them cool, some kind of heat exchanger. But sometimes we want it to be pretty low. In the case of a ceramic, for example, we want that to be low. In the case of a furnace, we don't want the heat to get out of the furnace, so we want some insulating things that are going to have very low conductivities. And you can see that there are up to 4 or 5 orders of magnitude difference. So huge difference in those. These can also vary depending on temperature, but there's usually not a strong dependence as long as it's not a really wide temperature difference. So conduction, transfer of energy through a stationary medium, usually a solid, but again, it can be a liquid, can be a gas, except that they can't be moving. So when we have enough heat on those, they usually want to move. They usually want to move by natural convection. So most of the time, we're looking at solids. One-dimensional heat flux. Again, you saw the equation, function of thermal conductivity, temperature difference, and the thickness of the material. Pretty straightforward. Insulating material, very low thermal conductivities, metals, very high, and again, it depends on what we're trying to do as to which one we want. Convection. Convection then is the movement of fluids, liquids, or gases. Transfer of heat using a moving medium, so it's some kind of fluid. Again, it could be a gas or a liquid. We can use our example of the coffee mug. And you could blow against the side of it, but that's not going to be very effective, again, because that's a pretty good insulator. On the back side, we'll have warm air, so the cooler air is coming out of our mouths. After the mug takes away some of the heat, then we're going to have warmer air on the back side. So the cool air is convection heat away from the solid, in this case, the cup. We can also do the same thing by blowing against the top, right against the liquid, and we have cool air blowing against the hot fluid, and we come on the backside with some warm air. So in that case, we're convecting away from the liquid surface. And if you've ever seen, they have some pretty cool videos on YouTube to show you that when you have a cup of hot fluid, could be coffee, could be tea, that actually starts to make some natural convection patterns inside. The reason is the wall's cooler than the fluid, so the fluid at the wall wants to fall down, it gets colder and more dense, and then when it hits the bottom, you get a recirculation. So you can see some of those videos, they put a dye in there and you can see it actually moving around. It doesn't move very fast, but it does move around. So convection that way, And then there's an example of the fluid motion that you might see inside if you put a dye in there. Probably don't want to drink it if it's got a dye in it, but you can at least see it for that. Our cars have an example of two kinds of convection. For our car radiators, we have the hot fluid entering the radiator, and then we have a gas, in this case air, blowing through the radiator to cool off the hot fluid so the cool water goes back to your engine and takes away heat from inside the engine. So we've got forced external convection and we've got forced internal convection. So the internal convection is the water, the external convection is the cool air. And I say that it's forced because it works when your car is moving. When I was a kid, they didn't normally have fans on the radiator, so when you're not moving, you're not getting any cooling. And it was not uncommon to see cars broken down on the side of the road with steam coming out of them because they had overheated. Today, when we're stuck at a traffic light, we have a fan that can come on and help supply that air even when you're not moving. So convection, internal for the water, external for the cooling air. And the equation for convection is also very simple. This is called Newton's law of cooling. We have a convection heat transfer coefficient H, cross-sectional area A, and then again the driving force, the hot temperature minus the cold temperature. Very easy equation. The challenge is to get H. There are literally whole books written on how do you calculate H. We've got internal convection, we've got external convection, we've got forced convection, we've got natural convection, all kinds of configurations. We got laminar flow, we got turbulent flow, we got transitional flow, and they've come up with correlations for just about anything that you can imagine. So the hardest part of the equation is H. Once you have H, then it's easy. And again, for the example of cool air over the surface, we have the surface area that's we're convecting away from, cold temperature, hot temperature, and the convection coefficient to go with that. That convection coefficient depends on a few different things. Properties of the fluid, so it depends on what kind of fluid it is. It depends on how fast it's flowing, especially if it's laminar versus turbulent flow. Depends on the direction. I'll show you a little picture in a minute of that or some things to think about. So if we have a fluid flowing parallel to the surface, that's going to give us one kind of heat transfer coefficient, as opposed to directing the fluid right perpendicular to the surface. So again, we'll have correlations for both of those. It's going to depend on the surface properties. For example, if you're blowing across a smooth surface, it doesn't transfer heat quite as well as it does if it's a rough surface. And the geometry, of course, is it flowing over a flat plate, over a cylinder, over a sear, inside of a cylinder, inside of a duct, all kinds of possibilities there. So it's going to strongly depend on the geometry. So the one on the left would be considered external force convection, whereas the one on the right is internal force convection, where it's flowing through a tube or a duct. So a sample calculation, if we have flow, we know how big this plate is, we know the temperature of the fluid, we know the temperature of the plate. So in this case, the heat is transferring from the hot plate to the cooling fluid. We've got a certain velocity, and we can look up or we can calculate what the convection coefficient would be for that. In this case, I'll tell you what it is, but again, that's really where most of the work comes in. If you know what that is, then the calculation is very simple. So we plug and chug and we get so many BTUs per hour for this convection heat transfer. So again, pretty easy if you have H. Here's an example of how you would calculate H in a particular geometry. So this one is the Nusselt number. It's a dimensionless quantity. This is how the common non-dimensional number or dimensionless number that we use for convection. We're not, frankly, interested in the Nusselt number. We're really interested in H. But the correlations are written in terms of the Nusselt number because that's an easy way to quantify them. So then once we know the conductivity of the fluid and some characteristic length, for example, in a pipe, the characteristic length is normally the diameter. So then we can calculate it for, again, a variety of situations. Another parameter that's normally important, or two other parameters that are important for to calculate the Nusselt number, Prandtl number, which is a property of the fluid. It's this quantity, and when you look up the tables, it's normally provided for you in the table. If it isn't, it's easy enough to calculate. The Reynolds number is an important flow characteristic, and we're going to use the Reynolds number to tell us, is this laminar flow or is this turbulent flow? So easy thing to calculate, assuming we know all the properties for that. So then, for both natural convection and forced convection, the correlations are normally written as some combination of the Reynolds number and the Prandtl number. In the case of natural convection, it's the Rayleigh number. So the Rayleigh number is a combination that includes the Prandtl number as well. So it's like the Reynolds number, but it's for natural convection. So a typical example would be, for Nusselt number, it'd be some constant times the Reynolds number raised to some power times the Prandtl number raised to another power. So pretty straightforward, and that's why we use the Nusselt number, because it's nice and easy to write. The other thing you have to know for any correlations you might use is how are they calculating the properties of the fluid? What temperature are they using? Usually, the most common one by far is what's called the film temperature, which is just the average between the fluid incoming temperature and the surface. Occasionally it's something else, and it normally is with the correlation, so just be careful that you pay attention to what that is. So here's what all these things mean. Here are the various units you might use. Again, this is for both natural convection and forced convection. Not hard. The key is to look up and find the appropriate correlation. You can usually do that, but occasionally you might not be able to find exactly what you're looking for. So what do you do as an engineer? Well, we get pragmatic. We find the closest thing we can find to our geometry, to our flow situation, and then we use that. But what you might do then, depending upon how serious the consequences could be if you were wrong, is you might build a bigger safety factor in. If it's not a big deal, then you may not worry about it. You might just say, okay, I'm going to use this. Occasionally, you'll have a correlation that extends beyond maybe the Reynolds number range that they got for this correlation. And again, we're pragmatic. We're going to use it. But just be careful. If it's way out of the range, then you may need to build a bigger safety factor in. So here's an example for laminar flow. For laminar flow, the nice thing is that we get exact correlations. These are exact analytic solutions. And in this case, the critical Reynolds number for laminar flow over a flat plate is 5 times 10 to the fifth. What that means is, if the Reynolds number is less than that, we say the flow is laminar. If it's more than that, we say it's turbulent. In reality, nature doesn't work that way. Nature doesn't have such a big discontinuity. There's really some transitional flow between that, but for most purposes, we ignore that. We know that it's there, but we just ignore it. And again, below that, we say it's laminar. Above that, we say it's turbulent. Nice, simple, clean formula. Again, this is exact. This is an analytic solution. The problem, unfortunately, is that in industry, we usually don't have laminar flow. We usually want things to happen faster. We usually supply fans and blowers and pumps and things like that to make the fluids move faster. So while this is a nice solution, it's not going to apply to a whole lot of problems for you in industry. Professors and textbooks like these because they're nice and analytic. You can derive them. You can show all kinds of cool stuff with them. Unfortunately, they're not all that useful for many kinds of flows. For turbulent flow, this is a correlation. This is based on collecting lots and lots of data. It's not an exact solution, and it does have a limit. So it's good between, in this case, the lower limit, the critical Reynolds number, and 10 to the 7th. So not a particularly wide range of Reynolds numbers. It's good for a really wide range of Prandtl numbers. Most common fluids are going to be well within that range. So on the Prandtl number side, you're good. On the Reynolds number side, maybe not so good. So let me give you an example. What happens if your Reynolds number turned out to be 10 to the 8th? What are you going to do? And that's the only correlation you can find. Again, we're going to be pragmatic. We're going to use it. It's the best thing we have, right? But you may build a little bit more safety factor because you're now outside the range, the alleged range of this when they developed it. And that happens sometimes. So that's forced convection. Another correlation for flow perpendicular to a surface. Again, it's got a Reynolds number range, and this one is fairly narrow. Again, empirical constants. And these Nusselt numbers are averages over the whole plate, which is usually what we want. There are other correlations. For example, if I go back a minute and I want to know what's the Nusselt number as I march down this plate, I can get those too. There are many correlations like that. So you can find the Nusselt number at any given place. Again, we usually don't care that in that much detail. We just want to know what's the heat transfer over the whole plate, but you could get it for in many cases. Here's fully developed laminar flow inside of a circular tube. Again, pretty simple correlation. In this case, it's just a constant. And this is an exact solution, but only valid for laminar flow. Here's a famous equation, it's called the Dittus-Boelter equation, for turbulent flow inside of a circular duct. Again, this is an empirical correlation. They've generated lots and lots of data and found that this is the best fit to it. You will find other correlations for the same geometry, and you'll get a slightly different answer. Which one do you use? Again, this is a judgment call. Maybe you even take the average of them. There are some other ones like this that are kind of nasty. This one happens to be from natural convection. It's got lots of constants in it, also based on empirical data. Not hard, but just a little bit more tedious to calculate. And this is for a vertical plate. It's going to be different if we have a horizontal plate. It's obviously going to be convect differently. So here's one, and it's slightly different depending upon what Reynolds number range you're in. If you're in this range, this is the one they recommend. If you're in the higher range, they have a slightly different formulation for that. So again, you'll try to get the closest geometry that you can, and based on either your Reynolds number for turbulent or for forced convection, or your Rayleigh number for natural convection, and then find out which one fits the best for your geometry and situation. So thermal convection, transfer of heat using a moving medium, such as a gas or a liquid, and the convection coefficient, that's really the only thing that's hard. The Newton's law of cooling is very easy once you get that. Radiation. Radiation is different than the first two. Radiation can go through a medium, but it can also go through a vacuum. It's electromagnetic radiation, electromagnetic waves. We can look at, for example, how the sun transmits its energy to us. Most of it's going through a vacuum through space. Then it hits our atmosphere and it can go through air. If you look at, for example, a fish tank, we can have radiation that goes through the glass and that also penetrates into the liquid. We're normally interested in thermal radiation. So thermal radiation is in this regime. The bulk of it is going to be infrared. As humans, we can't see infrared, but we can feel it. When you go outside, you feel the energy from the sun. Most of that's going to be infrared. And in the heater, in a combustor, in a furnace, that's what the most dominant one's going to be for radiation, is infrared. So you can look at these variety of them. Again, we're mostly interested in the thermal radiation. Three things can happen to radiation when it comes to a surface. We can have some of it go through the surface. We call that the transmission. And the fraction of it that goes through a surface, we call that the transmissivity. It's going to be something between 0 and 1. We can have some of it reflect off of it. That would be the reflectivity, again, a number between 0 and 1. And then we can have some of it that's actually absorbed by the surface. We call that the absorptivity, again, a number between 0 and 1. When you add all of these up, they add up to 1. So those are the three things that can happen. And those are going to depend on the geometry. So for example, if you have polished metal, let's say on your car surface, a lot of the radiation hits your car is going to reflect off of it. On the other hand, the glass glass on the window of your car, a lot of that radiation is going to go through the glass. We talked a little bit earlier about the greenhouse effect. So that sun's radiation goes through the glass of your car, heats up the things inside, is converted from a shorter wave radiation to a longer wave radiation, and that's less transmissive to coming out. So that's why your car heats up. The sun rays go through it, heat the inside, and most of it stays in. So it's mostly transparent to the incoming, but opaque to the outgoing. And then if you looked at a window in a house, let's say, if the sun is high in the sky like it is in the summertime, then a lot of it is going to reflect off of the window because of the angle. And they make special coatings to put on glass specifically to reflect the sun's energy in the summertime so you don't get any extra heat in your house and have to run your air conditioner hotter. So all these are dependent on what the surfaces are, what the angles are, and we get different effects for that. Black body radiation, this is the Stefan-Boltzmann equation. So we have the Stefan-Boltzmann constant, and then we have the temperature of the body raised to the absolute temperature to the fourth power. So in this case, in the cases of conduction and convection, you can use either degrees C or degrees F or degrees R or degrees Kelvins, as long as you use the same one, right? You can't mix the hot temperature and the cold temperature, be two different things. These have to be absolute, and it will make a big difference in your answer if you don't use that. In most combustors, this is going to be the dominant mechanism for heat transfer. The high temperature is going to make the hot face or the hot side very radiant, lots of energy from it. And here's just a comparison of some of the temperatures. Again, for radiation, we're going to be either degrees R or Kelvins. Again, this is another quirky thing. Technically, you're not supposed to say degrees Kelvin, you're supposed to just say Kelvins. I don't know why that is, but a lot of people say degrees Kelvin, and we know what they mean. So if we look at an example, if we had a temperature of about ambient, so roughly about what this room temperature would be, then we're getting energy out of this room, but this is not the net radiation. So it's saying surfaces are emitting roughly about that amount of energy, but what we're interested in is what's the net exchange, since everything is radiating in here. Everything above absolute zero is radiating. That was a black body. Real bodies don't emit perfectly. They emit some fraction of a black body. So that emissivity is something between 0 and 1. The closer we are to a black body, the closer we're going to be to 1. The closer we are to being a perfect reflector, we're going to be closer to 0. So that's going to depend on what the material is. So if we look at the same calculation as on the previous slide, the only difference now is that we have a real body that has an emissivity less than 1, then it just proportionally reduces the radiation. So if we have the emissivity, then we're going to have the radiant energy from that. Emissivity, so it varies widely. Again, there are whole books to give you emissivities for a variety of conditions. So in the case of aluminum, it can be very low, 0.09. And if we compare that to something like, in this case, oxidized steel, it could be close to a black body. So very wide difference. And you can even look at the same material, but under different conditions, it's going to have a different emissivity. These are all for iron, and it can vary from as low as 0.21 to as much as 0.6. So almost three times more, again, depending upon temperature and condition. Another challenging thing about this is that the emissivity can change over time. Again, if you have something that's going to oxidize like a metal, then you might have a nice polished one to start with, but after a certain amount of time, it may become oxidized, and that's changed, which means if you're doing these calculations, you need to be thinking about that. Should I use the emissivity today or what it will be at some point in the future, again, to be conservative. So emissivity, again, copper, from as low as 0.023 for polished up to 0.54, so more than a couple of orders of magnitude. Radiation calculations, again, we're interested in net transfer from one body to another. So we have the Stefan-Boltzmann constant, we have the surface area that's radiating, sorry, that's being received. We have the high temperature and we have the low temperature. And then we also have some view factor, which is purely based on the geometry. And we'll see in a minute what that means. So view factors, we've got a hot body and a cold body. If you took your two hands, for example, when your two hands are spread apart, your upper hand does not see that much of the lower hand. Most of the energy is going everywhere else. But if you move your hands really close together, then what's being radiated from your top hand is almost all of it's being received at the bottom hand. So that's just, again, pure geometry. When the surfaces are close together, you're going to get a high view factor. When they're pulled apart, you're going to get a much lower one. And this is an exact solution for the view factor between two parallel plates. We can also look at two plates that are perpendicular to each other. And again, we have an exact solution for that. You get hairier geometries and equations get nastier. We have some formulas. We also have some tables, some graphs that you can get some data like that from as well. So if we look at the emission from a black body at a certain temperature, it's over all radiant wavelengths from zero to infinity, but you can see really most of it is, in this case, roughly between about 2 and 12 microns. So that's a low temperature, but a black body. What happens if we double the temperature? If we do that, you notice a couple of things. First of all, the area under this curve is more than double the area under this curve. And that's because it's raised to the fourth power. Another thing you may notice is that the peak wavelength is now shifted to a shorter wavelength. We can look at 1500. Now a much more pronounced peak. Again, this area, even though we only increased it by 50%, we more than increased the area under the curve. And again, if you took a line down there, it's an even shorter wavelength for the peak, and of course you can keep doing this. Now what happens if you have something that's not a black body, that's something that we would call gray body? Well, it basically pushes the whole curve down. So this curve is now 80% of this curve, so every point has been pushed down. And this would be a real body. Peak is at the same place. What you can have for real bodies, though, is they're not going to follow this perfect smooth curve. You may have some dips and bumps in them. And again, that would be a real body that can have changes as a function of wavelength. We're usually not going to get into that much detail. In some cases, we do have that information, but it's going to be make the calculations a lot harder. And since this only affects a relatively small couple of bands of radiation, it's not going to impact our answers very much. Again, these are the things that we do as engineers, right? We don't worry about things like this because we're already making other assumptions, so that is not a problem at all. This would worry the physicists like Sheldon Cooper. He'd lose sleep over that. We don't lose any sleep over that, right? We're pragmatic. We got to get an answer. We don't need it to be perfect. We just need to be able to make whatever we're doing. This is gaseous radiation. This is some data from NASA. And you can see it's for different thicknesses of gases. And in this case, the gas is 50% water and 50% nitrogen. So it's a mixture of them. And what it's saying is that in some bands, it's very absorptive. And in other bands, like here, not at all. It's completely transparent. So the radiation goes completely through. It's not absorbed at all. And this kind of data makes the calculations harder. But what sometimes we'll do when we're doing computer modeling is we'll do what's called a band analysis, where we only will care about certain bands and ignore the rest. That makes the calculations easier and more tractable and faster to do that. So for water, it's got very distinct places where it absorbs. CO2 also has very distinct places where it absorbs. And NASA has collected a lot of this data over the years and has published it. So radiation, transfer of heat using electromagnetic waves, depends on a variety of factors, and we've talked about some of those. Last thing we want to talk about then is, okay, those are just some real quick basics on heat transfer. How does it apply to a combustor? How does it apply to a furnace? So let's look at a process heater. Bill's going to talk to you on Thursday with a lot of detail about a process heater. But for the moment, I'm just going to talk about some very basic things for a heater. The first thing is that the bottom part of the heater is called the radiant section. Why do you think it's called the radiant section? Remember, we're in heat transfer, so that's the clue.
Heat transfer by radiation.
Heat transfer by radiation is the dominant mode in the radiant section. It's not the only one, but it is the dominant one. We still have convection going on. We'll see in a minute. We actually have a little bit of conduction going on. But by far, the dominant mode is radiation. And they literally name it that because of radiation's dominance. The upper part is called the convection section. Any guess why they call it the convection section? Again, the dominant mode of heat transfer is convection. It's not the only one. There is radiation that goes on in the convection section, but by far the dominant mode is convection. So in these heaters, we literally name the sections after the dominant mode of heat transfer. Rough rule of thumb, about 60 to 80% of the total heat transfer happens in the radiant section, and about 20 to 40% happens in the convection section. Convection section does a really good job of capturing energy, which means that process heaters are by and large pretty efficient. Brand new ones can push 90% efficient, which is really impressive. If you look at other industries like the glass industry, the steel industry, cement, things like that, they're happy as can be if they're 50% efficient, much lower. Part of the reason for them is it's harder for them to capture the energy and use it somewhere in the plant. In the case of a process heater, it's in a refinery, it's in a chemical plant, lots of places where they can use energy. So it's easier to capture and use it. It's also lower temperature, so we have better equipment for capturing that. But again, by and large, these are very efficient devices. If you're a chemical engineer and you go to work in one of these plants, probably one of your jobs will be, what can we do to make these things more efficient? And what they're going to look at is the payback. So you've got a great idea to capture some energy, then you've got to figure out how long is it going to take us to pay this back. Most of our customers want at least nothing more than a 2-year payback. Some of them want less than a year payback. So again, it's not going to be what can you do, it's going to be what can you economically do, what can they justify spending on, because while they have the money, there are lots of things they can spend their money on. So they're looking for, obviously, the projects with the best payback. Again, very efficient processes. Here's looking up at the arch of a cabin heater. So let me try to orient you a little bit. The burners are at the bottom. You actually don't see the burners. You don't see any flames. They're firing upward. We're looking at the top. This is the convection section. These things that are glowing a little bit are process tubes. And these things that are glowing are tube hangers. The tubes are being cooled because they have a hydrocarbon fluid flowing through them. The tube hangers are not cooled. They just see all the heat. There's nothing flowing through them. They're made out of metal. So what we're looking for when we look at a picture like that is, do you see any obvious hot spots, places where it shouldn't be hot? These tube hangers are glowing, and they're supposed to glow. Nothing unusual about that. But we're looking for, are there any tubes that we can see where we might be getting flame impingement or hot gases that are hitting, in this case, the convection section? And in this case, this is a pretty good looking heater. It's not perfect. You're never going to, I don't think you'll ever look inside and find a perfect heater. This one looks pretty good. That's a nice condition. Again, Bill will talk to you a lot more about this on Thursday, but we're looking at heat transfer. And in this case, this is an ethylene furnace. We sometimes call this a cracking furnace. This is a computer image, and that's obviously a photograph. What's happening in these heaters is that we're trying to heat up the wall and radiate the energy to the tubes. This is a computer-generated image where they actually did some computational fluid dynamic modeling. In this case, they're only showing 4 tubes, but in reality, all these white spots, there were tubes in the model. They took the tubes out of the picture just so you could see the back of it. If they didn't take them out, you wouldn't be able to see the wall. These have what are called radiant wall burners in them, and they also have floor burners in them. The floor burners fire up along the wall. So these are against the wall. They're rectangular to get a lot of coverage on the wall. We call those flat flame burners. Bill's going to talk to you about that next Tuesday. Trying to heat up the wall. And then we have rows of smaller burners. We call these radiant wall burners. Unlike most burners like these, which fire up and out, these radiant wall burners fire to the side. They fire perpendicularly, and their job is to heat up the wall. These are pretty small, usually about 1 million BTUs an hour each, whereas these might be, you know, 10, 15, 20 million each. So these are much smaller, and there could be 5, 6, 7, 8, even 9 rows of these. A really big ethylene heater could have more than 1,000 of them in it. So lots and lots of them. Now, what's the purpose of these little ones? Well, the customer would prefer to just use burners from the floor and heat the wall up 45, 50 feet high. That's pretty hard to do with burners that are located in the floor. So we have to add these rows of smaller burners to make the wall as uniform as we can. The perfect wall would have the same temperature everywhere. This one's pretty good. You see a little bit of striping, but not too bad. So again, an ethylene furnace, the reason why these burners can't fire out like most burners do is these tubes are only about 3 feet away. So if you fired them straight out, those flames would impinge on those tubes. You'd have ruptures and lots of problems.